You're listening to the Kind Counseling Podcast. Please be sure to like, share, and subscribe. Now back to the show.
Welcome to the Kind Counseling Podcast. It's your man, Cammy Roberts. Today, I'm here with my brother, Alan Sue, and we're missing one of our co-hosts, but it's all good. It's all good. We got a good program for you guys here today. We're talking mental health and basketball, my two favorite topics, mental health and basketball. And today, hey, Al, how you doing, man?
I'm good, man. The weather is a little bad right now, but I'm doing good. It's raining, so no motorcycle riding, but I'm doing great, man. And yeah, basketball, mental health, great. And the NBA season about to kick off, so this is perfect timing.
Exactly, exactly. So today we have a special guest with us. We're not talking about a guy who's just scribbling notes on the side. We got a full-fledged author here, a legit. He got a book going on here. We got a brother who, you know, who writes, edits, all that good stuff. But I'm going to allow him to introduce himself, Mr. Ellie Ehez. Tell us a little bit about yourself today, man.
Hey, well, yeah, thanks again for having me on, Kami and Alan. My name is Ellie. I'm a native of Los Angeles. That's where, you know, I got my passion for basketball, following the Lakers as a young child. And eventually, even though I wasn't a writer by training, I eventually got into writing as like a kind of second hobby as a freelance journalist and editor. And, you know, while I did my day job, you know, I guess my night job was reading, writing, and basketball. And so those all came together, you know, when Kobe Bryant died a couple of years ago, and it led me to produce that book that you have in your hands right now.
Yes, sir. Right here we have, and the book is entitled What Kobe Left Behind, The Playbook from an Extraordinary Life. And y'all, I read this book. Go get this book. This book is legit. It is good. I'm a real basketball fan, big basketball fan. This is a good book. I'm not just saying that because he's here. Okay. So what inspired you to write this book?
It really just came down to, You know, again, growing up in LA, I was a huge fan of the Lakers, but really only at a superficial level, in that I was just so amazed at their, you know, rooted for them, huge fan of Kobe Bryant and amazed by his abilities on the court. And then, you know, and then I got into my life as an adult. And when he died a few years ago, I was just like blown away by the response, that it wasn't just Laker fans that were mourning his death. It was fans all from around the world, whether they even were rooted for Kobe or not, or whether they even really even enjoyed basketball or not. And so that, like, a light went off in my head. It's like, hey, look, Kobe must have been doing some great things other than just putting the ball in the basket that allowed to create such an outpouring of grief, and, you know, in that time. And so I wanted to know what it was. I wanted to know all the details of, like, what was Kobe like outside of the highlights, outside of the championship rings. And so I started doing deep research, going to every source that I can find, you know, uncovering every rock, trying to, you know, get, and through that process, I discovered that there is a secret set, well, not secret, semi-secret set of habits he developed over his lifetime that allowed him to be extraordinary beyond basketball. And it's not just something that makes him great. It can make all of us great if we understand those and if we you know, really see the stories of his experiences and see how those stories can apply to our lives.
Well, you know what? I was reading the book, and initially, and even when after Kobe died, I think I was, and people came out, and I thought it was really just because of the tragedy and how he died with his daughter that they were saying those things. So at first I was kind of like, they just saying that because he died. But then I, you know, and as I was reading your book, and I was saying, wow, this is, you know, because I remember crazy Kobe, right? Like selfish Kobe.
Yes, exactly.
Right, Kobe, who went at it with Shaq and his teammates, and that's the Kobe I remember. But then after he retired, it seemed like he had a whole different transformation.
Yeah.
So, you captured that really good in the book. Can you talk a little bit about that? Just like how he transformed from the 17-year-old kid to who he was before he died.
Yeah. Well, I think the first thing that I think was important is that, you know, Kobe was he had a relentless pursuit of excellence. He always was trying to find a way to be the best. And growing up, especially growing up in, you know, in Italy, in an isolated environment, he thought, well, look, I don't really connect with this community. All I have is the basketball. If I'm going to be the best, I have to do it all by myself. And yeah, that created a lot of success for him, but it only took him so far. And you know, as we know, the whole, you know, we saw the biggest problems with him occur with his in relationship with Shaq. But it was after that that he started to realize, hey, if maybe the goal isn't just to be the best basketball player, maybe the goal is to understand that if I want to be the best, I need to make other people better. And that's more than just passing them basketball. It's understanding what everybody else on my team is going through and how I can connect with them in a better way to motivate them to rise to the level that I play at every day. And as he discovered that through the second half of his career, especially with the mentorship of Phil Jackson, you know, he really recognized, hey, look, you know, I've learned things, you know, all the other things in the book that I've learned that have made me successful, I can imprint that onto my teammates if I understand where they're coming from and that they're not getting in the way of my success, but they can be the partners in our mutual success. And that's what really allowed him to get those two championships in the later half of his career, is that it wasn't all about him anymore. It was about the other players on the team who weren't superstars and helping them rise to the occasion.
What do you think separates him though from a lot of those players that he did play with, that he was able to rise to the superstardom that he did and some of his teammates didn't?
Well, you know what he said? He said this a number of times after his career or after he retired, is that when he, you know, his obsession with basketball is probably, I don't know that there's another player that was as obsessed as he was. And he said that when he entered the NBA as a teenager, he was expecting everybody else to be like him, to be like, oh, you know, so focused on the game, you know, practicing all day, all night, studying it, and just like, you know, all consuming. But he recognized that most of the players were not doing that. They had their own stuff going on, whether it was, you know, whatever their stuff, the stuff outside of basketball was more important than the basketball. And it clicked for him. He's like, oh, for them, this is hard work. For me, this is like what I was born for. So just from there, I've already won. I've already won because I pursued what's my true passion. Whereas some of these guys really just got lucky out of talent. And now that they've made it and they're financially stable, now, you know, they've kind of taken their foot off the pedal. But I'm not taking my foot off the pedal because this is what I was made for. So that, I think, separated him more than anything else.
Yeah, because you at one point in the book you said the trainer for the Lakers, I forgot his name, he said Kobe wasn't the most athletic, he wasn't the strongest, he wasn't the fastest. That surprised me because I always saw Kobe as really athletic, but it seems like his I guess most people have to be athletic, really athletic, to be in the NBA, but it seemed like his mindset separated him from everyone else then.
Exactly. Because yeah, there were, you know, if you just could look at the old, you know, the GOAT comparisons, right? You know, it's MJ or LeBron or other players. You know, LeBron, everybody sees like LeBron is a physical specimen, you know, or MJ has insane hops and huge hands that can palm the ball. But while Kobe did have his own natural gifts, he didn't have those kind of like extraordinary physical attributes that could allow him to just naturally dominate over somebody else. And so he's like, well, my attribute is my mind, you know, and it's really focusing on how to be good at all the details that these other guys, you know, miss or don't think about, because they're leaning on their talents and their physical abilities. And because of that, it allowed him to leapfrog over them, especially when, you know, through this process of coming, going from a preteen to a teenager to the NBA, you know, he continued to grow his skill set. Whereas most players, once they got to the NBA, they're like, okay, I figured it out. I'm good. I'm just going to coast. And that's why he's the complete frog over them, you know, literally, and do things that people thought were impossible.
Right. Now for you, let me ask, as you know, you said you're a Laker fan, right? What was something that after you finished writing the book, that you were surprised to find out about Kobe Bryant that you didn't know?
Gosh, that's a great question. I did not, you know, I did not know how much he was a giver, you know, and outside of the game of basketball, I was just shocked about how much he touched the game of women's basketball. Maybe that's probably the number one, and that's like later in the book. I don't know if you've gone to there yet, but the fact that almost every top WNBA player basically adores him, and not just because he's a great athlete, but because they saw Kobe as the biggest advocate for women's sports, period. And I'm like, you know, this guy is so, you know, so supposed to be known for being like really selfish and self-centered, only focus on his own goals, but he was giving so much to their goals that was just quite amazing. And it really, it was part of it's also you could call that part of the transformation in terms of, you know, when he died, it's like the response was so much different than what a lot of people expected who weren't paying attention. And it's really an example of how, you know, regardless of what happens to us in the past, there's always an opportunity for redemption if we really focus on how can we give our best to those who need it, you know? And that's what he did, and that's why his legacy is so strong.
Is that the most impressive thing that you found with him off the court was charity?
Off the court, I would say probably, but the thing that was interesting is it wasn't a charity in the sense of, oh, I'm gonna start a foundation or I'm gonna give money to all these groups or institutions or whatever, which is great, but it was about he was giving his time, you know. Mm-hmm. And you know, one thing I say in the book is like, you know, a lot of these high net worth individuals, they have a lot of money that they can spread around to make themselves look right. Like here, right. But we all have the same amount of time essentially, and so for him to take his time out and go and at the Melbourne Academy, go train with all these different young female athletes and give them their guidance, or for him to go be part of the Make-A-Wish Foundation and fly to a hospital, you know, halfway across the country to go see some boy who's dying, wishes to meet him, you know, to do all these things that you're not, that most people will not even hear about. Mm-hmm. That's where it's like, you know, it's beyond just you could almost, I don't call it superhuman, but it's quite impressive and extraordinary, as I say, that he went out of his way to make people feel heard and special and to lift them up, that honestly most NBA players don't do.
Okay. Now you, it's interesting that you mentioned the WNBA, because obviously one of the big issues that Kobe was known for was put in the spotlight for was the whole allegations around sexual assault.
Yeah, yeah.
Now you made an interesting comparison in the book between him and other people who had been accused of sexual assault. So can you talk a little bit about that? Because I know a lot of people remember him in that instance also.
Yeah, and it's a great thanks for mentioning that, because yeah, a lot of people who are not, or you know, who don't follow basketball closely, and will only, that when they think of Kobe, that's probably maybe the first thing that comes to their mind. Mm-hmm. And it's unfortunate because there's so much more to that story than meets the eye. Mm-hmm. And it's not even that, oh, he was completely innocent and he did nothing wrong and he's just being, you know, unfairly attacked. But it's also not that you know, he was completely guilty and he got away with a horrible crime. It's in the middle, but more importantly, you know, when I was writing that part of the book, I was thinking, okay, well, how can I compare it to, say, the Me Too movement and everything that happened with those Hollywood stars that were accused of sexual assault? And then when I started digging deeper into what happened with Kobe, it was like, he handled that situation much differently than most of those people. He didn't hide behind lawyers. He didn't, try to do victim blaming. He went out on the public in front of the cameras and really just bared himself to the world. And then on top of that, being willing to, you know, to consider an apology, which really illuminated some of the core issues behind, male-female relations, especially, and, you know, the idea of consent. That was also a big move too that most people don't recognize. So, and then, like I ended off with, you know, his documentary where he kind of went even deeper and basically just like confessed all this stuff that he felt like he was, you know, that tore up his family in regards to that whole incident. So he handled it a totally different way than most people in public, in the public space handled. Mm-hmm. And I think that it's a lesson that we can all learn from when it comes to how we respond to mistakes. Not that we should necessarily, you know, admit that, you know, just try and hide from the problem or get defensive or apologize if we have done nothing wrong, but just recognize that we're not perfect, and letting people know that we understand that, it will help us internally, but also help us to kind of reclaim some of our identity.
Okay. All right.
Did you find it hard writing this book as a Laker and as a Kobe fan and not being biased?
I think at the beginning, when I first had the idea of writing the book, it was really just going to be about, hey, you know, my mind was still focused on, you know, all the great things that Kobe did. And then as I started like really planning it out and doing all the research and talking to other people who are like, hey, you know, aren't you going to talk about this? Or aren't you going to talk about that? And then I'm like, well, you know, and I started thinking about it more. I'm like, actually, the book will be better if it's not just, you know, here are all the great things Kobe did. You should follow that. But if it's about, hey, Kobe was a human being who screwed up in major ways, just that some of us can definitely relate to, let's elevate that as well, because there are lessons in that just as much as there are lessons in, you know, when he scored 81 points. So once I reframed my mind, then it was easy, because then it was just about finding where the story goes from failure to success, or from making his mistakes to learning from them. And that's, at the end of the day, that's a better story, because they're really, none of our heroes are perfect. And it's in the way that they fell and try and make up for it. That's where the real story is.
Okay. All right. Now you, from the psychological piece,
yeah,
you mentioned reconceptualization.
Yes.
Okay? Which is, as a therapist, I find a lot of people struggle with that idea. And you go into it about, in detail in the book, about how Kobe was able to, we talk about his mindset again, where he was able to take what is a good situation or a bad situation or indifferent and use it to his advantage. If you could talk a little bit about that,
you're absolutely right. I feel like, especially when it comes to mental health, a lot of us, we only think about the good things in our life as being something we can cling on to, you know, but it's so much more. But he recognized that there's really energy in everything. And it kind of, and that's what really intrigued me, is his understanding of what reconceptualization means, and then connecting that with what, experts in the field like Dr. Caroline Leaf have really identified, in that it's not about, it's not that you pretend that that horrible thing didn't happen. It's about seeing it from a different perspective. So, and that's what I'm going to give the example of, like, if you're counseling someone who's gone through a horrible thing, you know, you want to, you know, help them see it from a different way. But what if that horrible thing happened to you? How do you do the same process on yourself? And he was an expert on doing that process on himself. And especially when it came to people trying to, put him down and attack him and tell him he was no good and really try to get his way of success, is he just recognized that, hey, it's fuel. It's fuel for my success. If I take that and say, oh, that hurts me, then they're going to win. But if I take that as saying, hey, that's more reason for me to prove them wrong, then it just fuels me to continue to work harder to show everyone that I belong in the NBA, or that I can win another championship, or that I can become a great storyteller outside of the NBA. And so it's quite fascinating. It's something that I think, yeah, it's totally applies it when it comes to therapy, mental health, and how we get out of our own way to be successful.
Right. Any other question?
What's your overall favorite Kobe moment as far as being on the court? And don't say against the Knicks.
we're gonna edit that part out if you say the Knicks, man.
I mean, something else.
Yeah, well, there have been a couple of nice moments against the Knicks, but you already know what those are, so I'm not going to bring them up. I do mention it. I do mention it in the book. It was probably the sixth. Well, the finals win against the Celtics was really nice. That was like the pinnacle of his redemption, and when it comes to on the basketball court, which so in that area, that's one of my favorite moments watching them. Exact revenge on Boston. But the other one would be when he scored 62 points in three quarters against Dallas.
Dallas, right.
Because it was just like, it was out of this world that he outscored them all by himself. I've never heard anything like that. And so it just really showed me that like his capabilities, he was just scratching the surface of his capabilities. Because like in that game, he didn't play the fourth quarter because there was already a blowout. And it's like, if he had played the fourth quarter of that game, who knows how many points would have made. So and it goes back to show that. And then like in studying for this book, it's like he really had no limits to his capabilities. But that's because he trained himself to get to that level. And it's like, okay, how can we do that? How can we each do that for ourselves to act even first, to even imagine something like that as possible? And believe like something like that is possible, and then create the plan that you can execute to actually reach that.
Okay. So I'm gonna ask you a basketball question, right? I think one of the saddest things in basketball was the breakup of Shaq and Kobe, man.
Uh-huh.
I mean, granted they lost to the Pistons or whatever, but it's I think the fact that the two of them couldn't navigate their relationship and put the team ahead of them, ahead of that. Mm-hmm. To me, that was one of the saddest things, man, because I felt like they could have probably won like five or six championships.
Oh, sure.
At least.
Yeah.
So as a Laker fan, how do you just even reconcile that, or even just, how do you see it?
I mean, I see it in a similar way. I would say that it's kind of like, I guess they you see that in a lot of pop culture and fiction, like the Avengers, for example, these group of superheroes that just all their egos are so big and they end up fighting with each other, it's kind of sometimes it's one of those natural things where the most powerful people also end up being the most arrogant and having the most conflicts with each other. And so maybe winning more than what they did could not have been possible because they were at the stage of their lives where they they were at the prime of their careers, but that also meant they were young and still kind of foolish. And so it's hard to have both. It's hard to be in your prime and still and be smart enough to navigate issues with your coworkers or your teammates or whatever. So it was unfortunate. And so I try still savor the fact that no other team has won three in a row since then, and say, hey, what they were able to accomplish in the midst of their turmoil, that in and of itself is amazing.
Okay.
Now, do you think that era of that type of player is over with? A player that stays with a team 20 years, you think that era is completely gone from the NBA?
I mean, if you follow LeBron, yes. If you follow Steph Curry, no. So
That's a good answer.
it really depends. I mean, you're seeing that now, especially like this off season, a lot of big moves, a lot of players demanding trades, and then you see what happens. So yeah, there's a lot of that happening. I mean, I think it really comes down to do players feel like the organizations they work with have their back? And if in the case in Portland, the feeling was no, because Damian Lillard had been there for like a decade and had nothing to show for that. But yeah, Golden State is a totally different scenario for Curry. So I don't think it's over. I don't think it's over. It just comes down to which organizations are going to put the team first, and those are the ones that the superstars are going to flock to.
Speaking of LeBron, all right, so.
Yeah.
All right. So now, from what I understand, now I'm not in Los Angeles, but what I understand, there's a segment of Laker fans who are Kobe fans that are not the most receptive of LeBron. Would that be accurate?
Yeah, I mean, it totally is. I mean, people I know just like, oh, LeBron is horrible. I, hated the fact that when he joined the Lakers, and I get it. And in fact, it's really interesting. So it's something that was kind of like a big contention when, or you with Kobe as well, because, well, I kind of saw LeBron as, oh, he's an amazing talent, but I was not a fan of the kind of like the, I think it really started with the whole decision thing back when he first
Yes,
left Miami.
yes.
Left Miami when he first left Cleveland to Miami.
Yes.
Really left a bad taste in a lot of people's mouths. Like,
Right.
it's all about him. It's not about any franchise. And then, like, after that, it's like, can you really count on him to be there for your team? However, and so then when he came to Lakers, it was like, oh yeah, this is great. I was kind of like split. I'm like, this is great. Lakers have been sucking the last few years, and I'm one
Right.
of the best players in the world. I can't hate on this, but at the same time, it's he's not really a he doesn't feel like a Laker. He feels like someone who's just trying to come in and get a ring or trying to be next to Hollywood, and that's why he's here. So, but I, when Kobe came in, and basically told he basically said, hey, look, I hear that a lot of people are hating on LeBron. But he's here. He's here to win championships, playing simple. And he knows that we don't hang up, division banners, hang up championship banners. So that's what matters most. And so I think he took a great like perspective of was like, y'all can remember we're here for championships, and it's what happens on the court, in pursuit of that really matters and really tells, hey, whether we should support him or not. So and I guess that's the way I look at it is, so there you go.
So you felt like Kobe kind of diffused that?
He tried to. I don't know that he was completely successful, but he did try to do that. And mind you, Kobe and LeBron go way back. Obviously, oh yeah, I think in fact, Kobe gave LeBron a signed pair of sneakers when LeBron was still a junior in high school. So that's technically when the connection began. But then they played, but the real
Olympics, right?
difference was playing with Team USA,
Right.
and that's how they really started getting connected. And so, if Kobe is BFFs with this guy, and he's saying like this guy, we should, put our, he's the right man at the right time. I mean, I can't argue with that. Let's put it that way.
I got you. I got you.
So who's the leader of the team, him or Anthony Davis?
I mean, it's still gotta be LeBron. I mean, Anthony, if he was not injured so often,
Mr. Glass.
you could say that. I think, yeah,
Right.
no, I know it's unfortunate. It's unfortunate. It's a challenge. It's a challenge. And LeBron, I mean, how his longevity, it is, no one can argue with his longevity. And that right there makes him the de facto leader no matter what happens. So it just depends on how long does he want to keep playing. So we'll have to wait and see. The NBA feels like the Lakers have a good roster this season, but it's can they actually make them work together to overcome some pretty tough teams out there, Denver's going to come back big, and Golden State's going to come back big. So it's not going to be enough to just get the conference finals. They have to win a championship, or fingers going to be pointing back at LeBron, just like they pointed back at Kobe. when the Lakers lost. But
all right, so I have a selfish question here before I get back to a more serious question.
Yeah.
How are you guys receiving Cam Reddish? All right. I was a big fan, man. As a Knicks fan, I felt like he got railroaded by the coach, man. So are you guys excited or y'all don't really care?
I mean, I think it really comes.
Nobody cares about Cam Reddish.
I mean, I don't have a big opinion on that. All I can say is we'll find out when the season starts to say who was on the, benefited from that change. So we'll have to wait and see, you know?
So clearly you're not excited. All right.
I just like, you know, hey, show me what you know, show me what you can do, and then I'll get excited.
I got you. So all right.
I have a question. As a writer, what was the hardest part? Not as far as putting down words to paper, but what was the hardest part of getting your book published and out?
Well, I was initially looking at doing it traditionally through a publisher. And I did have some connections, first of all, it's super hard to get any, first of all, you need to have an agent first to even be able to talk to a publisher. And so when you go contact agents and go through their process, it's hard. You'll be lucky for any of them to even get back to you, let alone tell you that they want your book. So, it's really hard. And, you know, 'cause I sent my book to a bunch of different agents and only a couple got back to me. And one was just like, well, there's other books out there that are kind of similar. I don't think she even really, read my manuscript, which was almost completely done. So it's like, hey, you know, I can lean back on an option that I'm already familiar with, which is self-publishing through Amazon. And I would recommend, two things really important for people who want to say they want to write a book is that, I would almost by default say do it through Amazon, because you look at the book that I got that I sent to you, their self-publishing program creates books that are such high quality, you couldn't tell that it didn't come from a real public, that it didn't come from a so-called big five publisher. Right. Both hardcover and paperback that look like they belong in Barnes and Noble.
Yeah.
And secondly, you get to keep more of the money that you make through royalties of the book than if you went through a traditional publisher. The publisher will give you an advance and give you, we're going to send you a little bit of money, or you're going to send X thousand dollars as an advance, but that's probably the only money you're ever going to see from selling the book. But Amazon, you have more, doing it through Amazon, you have more control over how you're marketing the book, what the pricing is, what the, what the format is, all of that. And even with another thing is that publishers don't really do a lot of the legwork. I think what the hardest part is. The hardest part isn't writing the book. In a way, the hardest part is like what happens after the book is written, because even if you have a publisher, you still have to do all the legwork to get people to see your book. Whether you want to hire a publicist, whether you want to market it on social media, whether you want to try and get on people's shows or do book signs, whatever, you got to still do all the work to promote your book, because the publisher is really not going to do that work for you. So it's like, okay, why am I going to follow a publisher and follow all the rules when they're not really going to do that much for me it's still on me. And so that's why, even though this book's great, in my opinion, and I'm glad that you guys feel the same way it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter how great it is if nobody can see it. And that's like my part of my job right now.
True. So you pretty much have to do the marketing and of the book. Okay.
Yeah. Even if you went through a traditional publisher, you got to do most of the marketing and you could hire somebody to do that for you if you have the budget to do that, but it's still mostly on you.
I got you. So now I have just getting back to the book for a second. Now, would you say that just life in general, just growing older in age, or like, was it therapy, asking questions? Like, what do you think helped Kobe to transform from that self-centered person to a mentor and eventually a hero? Like, what do you think was most influential with
that? I think it's when you hit rock bottom, in a way. I think part of it is, and many of us, there's many stories about people, sometimes people only change when they don't have a choice.
Right.
And that's what happened to him after Shaq had left, and he had a couple seasons where he was the best player, scoring insane amounts of points, but his team sucked and he couldn't get them anywhere in the playoffs. And, you know, the turning point was, in my opinion, was the summer of 2007 when he demanded a trade, which a lot of people forget about. And his coach refused to trade him.
Right.
And, he didn't have to because of the contract, and then he's still on contract for a couple more years. So the way I say Kobe was really at an impasse. He's like, I can't go to another team and I can't get him. I can't get the coach to trade all the players on my team that I think suck. So I've got to find out. So now I have no choice. I've got to try a different way to win. And then it was kind of like, maybe my coach was right the whole time that maybe I should practice this thing called empathy to try and connect with my players instead of running over. So yeah, I think it really came down to that.
Okay. I was the title of the book is What Kobe Left Behind. So one of the things that he left behind was obviously his wife and children.
Yeah.
So I was just going to ask you, in your research, did you, anything that you, you found out about that, or just, any updates you can give us on that? Like how they're doing?
I think from what I can tell, they're doing great. I know there's that, at least, I feel like the family is doing amazing. You know, they have their own foundation that they actually renegotiated their contract with Nike on the Kobe shoe line, and then they are partnering with women's college sports teams to support them. Wow. You know, I know that the Bryants won that lawsuit against the police, and they have such a great support network. Pau Gasol apparently is like one of their BFFs.
Right.
You know, he's always hanging out with them. So they have a huge support network, and from what I can tell, we've rarely seen, Vanessa, take up, speak or really be a very public figure. But just from what I mean, it's happening, you can tell she's a very strong woman. When she wants something, she does everything to her power to get it for the benefit of her family. And so I think they're in a good place despite everything that's happened.
Okay. All right.
What's the biggest thing you think he's changed as far as how the game is played?
That's a great question. I think he really helped players understand that the technique matters. The technique matters more than talent. And you see it. And like, I think for me, sometimes like I'm in Dallas right now. And so watching, I've watched the Mavericks play and seeing somebody like Luka Doncic, when you look at him, he doesn't look like he's a stud.
I feel like I can guard him, man. Yeah. I feel like I can guard him.
He doesn't look like he's a stud, but then he's on the court. He does all these crazy spin moves. And then because it's all in the footwork and in the ball handling and all of these little, in the faking and all these little counter moves that you don't think of that, you don't see it. And it's like, oh, he's a huge talent, but he actually trained with Kobe before, in LA at the Marvin McCloud, he trained with Kobe. So I'm sure he picked up skills from Kobe that I can clearly see when I would go and watch him play. And you just understand that, the technique and the details matter, and it can allow me to, to beat people who think they're better than me.
Right.
Also, low cut sneakers. No, he did. He was like the first one to do that. Like,
that's true.
That's a good point. That is a good point.
Now everybody does it. I thought that was, I didn't know that he did that until I was one day did a research. I'm like, why are these guys all wearing like running sneakers?
One thing I thought of is maybe he did that so that everybody would follow him, and then it'll be easier for them to break their ankles.
Hey.
Okay. I guess. Wow. Well, Ellie, what, just in terms of, like somebody who's buying this book, what do you think, What do you think they're going to get out of this? Like, just from all the sweat and work you put into it, what do you think they're going to get from it?
They're going to get out of it. Hey, you know, well, first of all, somebody who's a basketball fan is going to get a just really amazing trip through time and feel like they're brought along into a story that of Kobe that they didn't even know existed, which is an adventure in of itself. Just discovering all the different stories that are behind the scenes of Kobe's life. But then at the higher level that everyone can enjoy is understanding the different techniques that he developed that allowed him to become so legendary. And so, and it's like, and then reflecting that back on yourself, it's like, hey, I've gained something from this book that I can actually use in my life. I mean, for example, for me, meditation was one of those big things that before I read this book, I was not a, I really did not believe in the idea of meditation. I thought it was a waste of time. But once I was doing my research, I'm like, damn, he's really big on this stuff. And so I started doing it myself. And then I'm like, wow, now, you know, after doing it for a few weeks, my focus was so much better in meetings. Mm. I was, the daydreaming was a lot less. It was a lot easier to really focus, get stuff done, and not be distracted by things, other things. So I'm like, damn, he was really onto something. Mm. And I would love for, I believe that every person can find something in the book that, and come up with like, oh yeah, he was really onto something. Let me try this thing in my life and see how it benefits me.
Okay. All right. So Al, you have any last questions?
No, I'm good.
All right. So Ellie, just in terms of the book, obviously here we have on the book, it's What Kobe Left Behind. There you go. I don't know if mine is is it the right?
No, you're in the right way. Maybe mine isn't. Maybe mine isn't.
Okay. All right. So tell people where they can get the book.
Yeah, just go to Amazon.com and look it up. Or if you go to whatkobeleftbehind.com, they'll redirect directly to the Amazon listing. It's super simple.
Okay. All right. So any last words before we go? Anything you want to tell the audience?
Yeah, just to tell them that, hey, you know, whether you have someone in your family, a friend or family who loves sports, or whether you just want to try and learn how to be a better person, I think there's something here that you could gain from, you know, and again, whether you're a Knicks fan or a Laker fan, you'll find a way to respect it.
What's your predictions for the season?
Yes, yes.
Ah, gosh. I mean, Denver's just so strong. I you know, all these other teams that have shifted around still have to learn how to work together, whereas Denver has figured it out. So I'm still probably going to go with them, and we'll see what happens over in Milwaukee. Maybe them two in the finals. That would be my bet.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you, sir. We appreciate your time. We appreciate your efforts and your talents. I love the book, and keep up the good work, man.
All right. Thanks. Thanks, guys. Appreciate it.
All right. Take it easy.
Yeah.
All right.
If I ever took a loss, I learned a lesson. I won't ever think I'm better than the next man. I've been down before to come up, I ain't stressing. Baby, I'm too busy counting.